Shalom, Islam, Shalom, Alaikum, Alhamdulillah, Mashallah. Good morning, y'all. What's up? What is up? Welcome back. Welcome back, people. Appreciate everybody. Appreciate every comment, every moment, every second that y'all choose to come in and trust y'all time with me, man. It's a big ass place and it's a lot of fuckery to get into. So everybody to come here, I appreciate y'all. Absolutely. Shout out to nephew Jarrell. He sent me something and it's about the date is coming up, Thanksgiving, and how they try to trick you into, well, we right there. Appreciate you, nephew. I'm gonna read that to y'all. This is what Rel sent me this morning. It's pertaining to Thanksgiving. We all know the story of the pilgrims and how the first American Thanksgiving came about. What we do not learn or may not know, what the elementary schools do not include in their plays and skits, is more about the Native Americans and pagans that influence Thanksgivings. For instance, did you know that the tribe of Native Americans that had their meal with the pilgrims was called Wampanoag? They held celebrations and gave thanks to Keaton, the creator. Not only did they believe that their most precious crops was corn was a blessing from him, but they also gave thanks to many of their other spirits for the other food they ate. They had a harvest festival at this time of year every year. The great feast held in 1621 was a pagan feast. Before Thanksgiving was made a holiday in the year 1861, settlers had already brought their traditions to America, all influenced by pagans. After all, Thanksgiving is about giving thanks and harvest, right? Celebrating and giving thanks for a harvest can be seen throughout history in many cultures, just to name a few. Ancient Rome gave thanks to Ceres, goddess of the harvest. The ancient Greeks honored Demeter, called Thesmophoria, Thanksgiving. Celtic pagans and Anglo-Saxons had huge celebrations. Laganasath and the Mabon, these were to honor the first and second harvest, blessed upon them by their goddess and God. The pilgrims who first settled in the Americas almost starved to death as they had no hunting, farming, or fishing skills. An Indian tribe came to help them and showed them how to farm, fish, and hunt, herbal medicines, and much more. This tribe was called the Wampanoag. The person who helped them mostly was Squanto, an ex-slave prisoner who escaped but learned excellent English from his captors. Later, the tribes were massacred. So was Squanto, as were many Native American tribes throughout the Americas. And again, y'all always talk about the natives in America. These natives were basically us. The African story, all these stories. Hopefully today with the video, that the points that I play from, you understand that generally all the literature that we had came from at the hands of the Romans or the Jews, who were one and the same. So I wanted to speak on, I don't know if any of y'all heard, and I don't like to do like current events, only as they pertain to the word of God. And this recent thing that happened in Wisconsin, right? SUV plowed over maybe 48 people, 5 died, I think 18 was kids, so forth and so on. And everybody's talking about, yo, this is, it's tragic. And the only reason it's tragic is because people don't see or people don't know God's hand on it. This is the incredible part. Shout out to Munch. We was talking about this today and she said they don't know how it works. And she is 100% correct. Like, to see the hand of our creator on anything, it takes some skill. It takes some you being out of your emotion. It take practice to practice the word of God. Like, that takes practice, because the SUV that mowed down all these people, if the creator, if it wasn't in his forecast, if it wasn't in the will of the creator, none of that would have happened. And I think people that fraudulently believe in the creator will never understand that. And he made that clear to me with my own illness, with my own supposedly life-threatening illness with the cancer. I saw exactly what I meant, you know, nothing. And I don't mean it in that sense, but Munch loved me, my kids love me. But on the grand scope of this world, Don't nobody else here give a fuck about me. I mean, the people that I made contact with, y'all, that's a different thing because we intimate. But in this world where it's telling you people, 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 you never see these people and you never give a fuck about these people, right? But every time something happens to one of these people, they get the legitimacy of how important that they really are. Then you're not chasing all the shit that the world told you to chase. Well, what happened to me is that happened. You know, I was forced to disconnect from the kumbaya-ness, the oneness of, even if it was fuckery, it's still oneness. Every Christmas, Thanksgiving, it's all of this shit now. People going in and out of stores, they automatically saying happy holidays to you. Like, you have to be a part of this shit. So with the rest of the people, life never changed for y'all. Y'all kept the same beat, the same clock. That shit changed for me. And once you got pulled out, now you're a subject. Well, you're a prime candidate for taking in the truth. It always come with tragedy or something that potentially can stop your clock. So my mind state, I didn't give a fuck about anything else in the world or what they could poison me with, because now that's the ultimate point. I don't need any more poison. I'm at the point where the poison is taken and I'm about to check out. A lot of these people that come in here and want to have philosophical battles and shit and talking about this verse and that verse, I know you don't even believe it for trying to live inside of a verse and go at somebody battling who, if you, and this is another qualify about walking shit out, and that's why I appreciate y'all so much. Y'all invested the time in me, so if I was a fraud, at least y'all had the wherewithal to say, look, you did this, you did that, and it ain't some half-cocked person that come in. I've learned that on Periscope through that war, just addressing people that don't matter. You know, they're stuck in a place. So anybody that's commenting negatively in something that you don't like, you just told on who you was. That's me coming out the matrix. I'm not fighting dummies. It don't make sense anymore. You know what I'm saying? When you walking in your power, that's just somebody that's confused about themselves. So I come here and I feel free to share because I'm sharing with y'all that's listening and that want to hear. And I know what I'm talking about. The world will tell you that they got the experts, that their view matter. Well, I've been exercised from that too, because the cancer is nothing more important than that. You know, the decision that you make, well, which you want to be shot with, a 32 or 45. That's the decision with cancer, right? Chemo or no chemo. That was it. I didn't take the chemo. That's the science. The science says take chemo. The science said I would be dead in 5 to 6 months. That's not what God said. So don't come in here with your verses trying to catch me up on, he slipped on his tongue, he did this, he did that. I welcome anybody that's against me to just do the shit that I did, and then I'll follow you. And if you haven't heard this video, you'll be in another video trying to talk shit, and I already laid down a parameter. So when y'all come and say shit to me, I know you haven't seen anything, nothing. You heard one word and then you did what every other dumbass do. You think that, oh, I'm gonna take them down. You're not gonna take me down. I'm here because the creator want me here. As well as those people that got mowed down in that Christmas pageant, the creator wanted them out of here. So I tell everybody, it's not about this word. For real, you need to stay away from me. You know, I'm the worst thing for you because I'm fully available for the creator. It ain't about nothing that I'm talking about. So you really get exposed if you're not about that coming through here, because y'all parameters don't have any effect on me. I don't wish to be a part of any of y'all groups. And I stand on that to the death that I stood on the cancer with. Y'all ain't never made no conscious life or death decision. It's always about money, about your fucking heartache, theoretical shit. Praying. It was no prayer for me to do. None. It was order for me to keep. Why would I need to pray to a God that said, all of this is yours, just keep my word? See, I'm gonna let y'all know. Y'all don't understand. Munch said they don't know how it worked. So for the people that I have some kind of feelings for, that might not know, it's information for them to grab. For y'all that think y'all know everything, stay the fuck away from me then. You go to your place and do your thing. I ain't no competition with none of you ass wipes. I came to give the information that the creator gave, made available to me. Because I understand what it is. It ain't none of my agenda in this. My agenda got taken away with the cancer. So I came here to teach the word of God. And if you don't want to learn it, get the fuck away. To anybody that's interested, we going to do this, y'all. And these times is wide open again. It's a tragedy for everybody to see that SUV go through that Christmas pageant and mow these people down. It's a confirmation for me that God is who he said he is, because this Christian shit, that's y'all day, right? Y'all brought it up and gonna dumb it down like you do with the homosexuality, all the other lies. And when God show his hand on that shit, y'all don't even know how to take it. You deflect all this news, this suspect, the person that did that shit, he did it because he was evil, right? That was an evil thing that he did. And the evil was the option that he had. So he didn't have to do it. But that was the option that the Creator offered us. The light, the darkness, the good, the evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. They his creations. Isaiah 45 and 7 tell you that, right? So this guy who don't want nothing to do with the Lord, so he think he going to be evil, you still going to be whored out for the Lord. Because now we got this Christmas pageant, right? And these people out here celebrating other deities, pagan deities. Per the Lord, per a little reading for y'all. You know, we always establish it with the reading. Make no mistakes about it. And that's what I use the book for. Not some obscure verse or trying to guide people down a path I want them to go down and go, fuck my path. This ain't about me, obviously. You know, I have no cure for cancer. That was obedience. Thus saith the Lord, do not learn to go the way of these heathens, and don't be dismayed by the wonders in the sky, the stars, the moon, the sun. This Jeremiah 10 and 2, you know what it is, nephew. For the laws of the nations are delusions, for it is the work of a craftsman's hands. He cut down a tree in the forest with an axe, adorns it with silver and gold, fastened it with nails and hammers, so that it is not totter. They're like a scarecrow in a cucumber patch. They cannot speak, so they gotta be carried. They cannot walk. Be not afraid of them, for they can do no harm. Nor is it any of them to do any good. It's vanity. This is your Christmas that you're celebrating. Saturnalia. You understand? Winter solstice. And even more. Even more for you, Christian. I got you. What's this fool name? Pat Robinson. Talking about Christian being paganism. This is a Christian pastor. 700 clips.
Didn't shock you. I'm not.
Let's see.
Mass thing.
Holiday. While I agree that Jesus may not have.
Right.
Okay, this is David, who says, we have friends who do not celebrate Christmas because they say December 25th is really a pagan holiday. While I agree that Jesus may not have been born on December 25th, he certainly was born as described in the Bible. How do I respond to them?
Well, in a sense, tell them they're right. You see, the winter solstice a couple days later was the shortest day of the year, and the pagans had something called Saturnalia. And it was a time of lawlessness because all the laws were suspended. And people, a bunch of singers were actually wandered the streets naked singing. And then they had orgies, sexual orgies. It was a mass thing. Well, when the Catholic Church came along in Italy, the Romans and others didn't want to give up their holidays. So they said, okay, we'll Christianize it. And so they said, okay, we'll say the birth of Jesus was the 25th of December. Then there was a monk who began to add it up. You see, if you read in Luke, it says there's a census taken when Quirinius was governor and so forth and so on. And they could take those leaders and figure the exact time dating from the foundation of Rome. And that's when the dates were established. And so they get pretty close to the date. But to say it's the 25th shepherd.
Now you're trying to save the ship. Some of the clips, the audio that I play later on is from some people from some so-called oppressors, right? This is another thing about the whole black-white situation. Believing in God and understanding to have a real firm foundation in the Creator now, The black white thing is just another, it's rain, it's snow, it's sun, it's black and white, it's mosquitoes. This is another one of those things that's insignificant. The man put an enormous amount of weight on for nothing. All of us are people, right? And you see people trying to make categories for murder, categories for hate. If a white person do something, it's extra hateful. You know, if this happens, if you don't like a Jew, you anti-Semitic. And what I'm finding out, and the Jews as bad as the Christians, actually the Romans, they're at the foot of this shit. And I got to read from Abraham, too, to give y'all some foundational information about how the Jews can't even exist. Let me jump in real quick. Abraham was not a Jew. Abraham was not a Hebrew. By bloodline, Abraham would be a Chaldean and an Iranian, Iraq, in that area. That would be his bloodline. So it's no such thing as a Jewish bloodline. Y'all understand what I'm saying? In this conception, it's no Jewish bloodline. They were called Israel. And what y'all gonna get today is how they changed history. And the Romans and the Jews are linked together. The Jews, the people that practice Judaism, Hasmoneans, when you hear the story of the Maccabees, this is all Roman and this concept. And these audios that I play today, they explain how Rome, what they did as far as religion, and this whole way that we live today, this whole system that you live under today is mirrored of the Roman rule back in the day when they took over from Greek. They never gave up control. How they go about the control is different. It's a different set of tricks that they use today. And foundationally, if people could lock in on just the scripts, just the word of God, it would spell everything out, because they're giving so many passes for shit that's happening. People backwards calling the hand of God evil, or the work that God do evil. God said he created the evil, all of that. So if evil is coming your way, wouldn't that be by the hands of God? Like if you did something, and the book actually states that, what is it, nephew? Proverbs. No, it's Psalms. Psalms, I believe, y'all. Psalms has the most books in it. Psalm 78 and 49. Now, this is from the book that support the word of the creator, not the word of man. So when you try to get an understanding of this book, don't understand it with your lenience in mind. Understand it with the firmness of God, or for the book being used for good, because the people, the Romans, the Jews, they wrote it in a literary form and tried to make the stories more important than the laws. They tried to give you a backdrop. And these people that I'm reading about, their problem was paganism. Their core problem was existing with these people, the Romans, the whole story. And hopefully today, and then on your own, you can look at some stuff, because don't just stop from here. You know, get the seeds, water them, go out and grow your own. But for me, it's therapeutic. And I owe the creator. As much as people out here jading his word, amalgamating it, I got more time than any of them. More time than any of them to sit here and do this. Because at one point, money is required from them to continue in what they're doing. It's not required for me. I don't have to move from the place. This is the life that the creator blessed me with, because he knew I wouldn't stop. Some days it's frustrating when you see the shit, but those are days that your prayer come in, like you staying focused and knowing that the creator gonna have the last word. And then when I see shit like Christmas pageants getting mowed down, I see it different. People see it as, oh my God, a tragedy. I see it as, oh my God, it's talking to me. You know what I'm saying? That's how I see it. And that's how I'm going to push it. And people are going to stay away from me because I'm telling them what God doing, or they gonna come into it. So I appreciate y'all that do here. All of y'all that stand on the other side of it, you don't stand on the other side of me. So I don't give a fuck. You don't stop nothing that I'm doing. You don't stop the hand of God by saying it's not, or you acting like that. you know more about God in a theology sense. Nobody gives a shit about passing a test or y'all rituals. They was just performing a ritual when that SUV came through there and mowed them down, their annual Christmas parade, their walk, their paganistic celebration, and they got mowed down. And y'all don't think the hand of God was on that? Y'all are sick ones. Y'all are Biden voters. Y'all are ones living in a fucking fairy tale land. All these other gods and fucking rituals that y'all do. And don't none of it save y'all. Y'all still been in the same position. I done separated from all of that. And it didn't take the money. Didn't take it. The shit that y'all about to go through, we ain't gonna feel none of it. Because y'all subscribe to it. And it ain't about your money. Your money ain't gonna save you. The minute they want to shut you down from your job, you saw what happened. Those are the people that you need to worry about. They don't affect me. They never will. That's not the will of the creator for some other god to rule. Y'all bow down to that shit. I'm gonna show you how today too. Psalm 78 and 49. He cast upon them the fierceness of his anger, wrath, indignation, and trouble by sending evil angels amongst them. That's Psalm 78 and 49, 78 and 50 says, he made a way to his anger and spared not their soul from death, but gave their life over to the pestilence. That's happening. What's a pestilence? A disease? What's evil? With that SUV plowing through senior citizens, children, people of all ages, Lord knows the Most High don't kill no babies, man. He don't kill no babies. That can't be right. Because that's the narrative that Christianity pushes, that God is this pussy God that just let y'all go around doing what y'all want. Because y'all don't recognize his hand on your fucking neck. You keep moving. I'm going to show you God's hand. That SUV, that shit, that's by the hands of the creator. Did he stop it? Y'all always talking about it was by the hands of God. I was blessed that I didn't die in it. So if you died in it, then it wasn't a blessing to God. It was his curse, right? So what is it? I just need to know, like, comment. What is it? What do you think? Was it just by chance that those people got killed at that spot? Or y'all about that, what y'all talk about, and believe in the creator for real? Because it ain't some squeaky clean job. That ain't nothing that I saw with Israel and these people. That's not the lesson that's in there. You know, that's not what happened. It was a whole bunch of pagan idol worship, a whole bunch of going to war, a whole bunch of disease, because they couldn't worship the way that the creator had told them. They got mixed up with all these pagan nations. Pagan, your Christmas, that's pagan. Your Thanksgiving, that's pagan. Your birthday, that's pagan. Stargazing, star worship, that's pagan. Yet you do all of it and bitch and complain that the white man is over you. He said he would send a fierce nation to put over your asses, not black people, people that turned their back on him. The so-called white man has had his foot in your black ass since as long as you can remember. That's all you remember. You don't have no memory or nothing else except the white man with his foot in your ass. That's some sad shit. And you keep blaming the white man. Do you think that a people that the creator had blessed or had favor on would be stomped out, muddled, and have to suffer? You out your mind? They teach you long suffering in Christianity. Then you got this other group of fuckers, lying ass fuckers, just calling themselves the Jews, that you can't see a bloodline. You cannot see a Jewish bloodline. What Jew is a religion that was jacked by the Hasmoneans. The whole Maccabee story, it's a lie. All of this shit ties in with Christianity, but nobody's attacking the Jews because they're afraid. They're afraid to attack that lie that they told. But in this book, Torah, the one that they claim, it showed that they liars. Straightway, I'm going to start from Abraham today, y'all. This is Abraham from Wikipedia. Abraham is the common patriarch of the Abraham religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. So all three of them come from there. How did they get so different? How? How do you go from this guy with the covenant? Because now I'm going off the narrative of the story. This is the backdrop. This is not the law of God. As long as I keep the law of God, I'm good. But this is a study guide for me. And this is showing something, that Jews don't exist. You know, they want to say it's Judaism. It is not Judaism. It's 12 tribes. It wouldn't be named after one. They was called Israel together, right? But now the religion is called Judaism. I'm not going for that shit. I don't care what kind of Jew, whoever says what. I don't care about you. You're not over me. I have eyes. I can read. This information, you fucked up and left any of it out here. Because some of us would have the spirit that we need. And now the time is perfect because the world and lied so much. And you seeing the lies double back, roll over. They determine that the common cold is killing people. If you die, that's the hand of God. Now they even trying to play God and scare y'all simple asses in the mask. So when I'm looking at you cowards, I'm like, nigga, y'all forgot about cancer. You forgot about HIV. The flu killed more people than that shit. And I don't care what their numbers say. They can punch in whatever numbers they want. A little while ago, Cuomo had the best numbers in dealing with COVID in the whole United States. Now we find out more people died fucking around with Cuomo, the serial feel of like all of this shit that the media give you. They take you where they need you to go. The foundation of our creator, Allah, it will keep you right where the fuck you need to be. And it's your fault if you can't see people outside of his word because you love her ass. That's your man. You make money with this person. That ain't gonna work out for you. It's not gonna work. Recently in the bodybuilding world, a bunch of bodybuilders having heart attacks. A couple of them died. Cali Muscle had a couple, one heart attack and one scared. And throughout their life, early on, they taking these supplements, right? Getting ripped, living a life. That period, they untouchable and everybody praised them. Now the unjust game came back. The claim is, right? You got people having heart attacks, people falling out. Check out bodybuilding lately. And I'm looking at these sites, I'm checking these people out, and they're still making up lies for why these people are dying. It's like trying to cheat, trying to get an unjust gain, right? And for a while, that's people in life with their money, their women, all this shit, their titles, but it never lasts. They always fall because they fake fucking idols. You will never have an idol that does not fall. It's not going to happen. The creator told us not to have idols, and he gonna break every last one of your fucking idols. They gotta be broken because they come between you and the creator all the time. So all these bodies, look, they was all dieseled out a whole time of their life. Now they fucking invalids, heart attacks, all of that shit. When I tell people, I'm about 170 pounds now, posted a picture yesterday to my IG when I was lifting weights. I was about 185. I was bigger than I am now, but I wasn't stronger. I'm way stronger than I am now, just doing calisthenics. And that's because I use functional strength. I did get cut up. I like the way I look. I was a little bigger before, and it's nice to be a little bigger, but I'm a lot more functioning and a lot more stronger now. So it's not even a sacrifice because I don't look horrible now. So what I'm saying is the weights, if you're lifting weights, I hope it's for a competition or something. Like, if you're not bodybuilding and it's not your thing to look a certain way for competition, I wouldn't touch weights. You know, it's no advantage of lifting weights for functioning. Now, for show off, you want a specific muscle to look a certain way. Of course, it's advantage to that, but that's not a functioning advantage. That's a, oh, look at that muscle advantage. Like I said, Ronnie Coleman can't beat me in a foot race. He got plenty of muscles, but the ones in his legs don't work right because something happened to his back as a result of lifting all that fucking weight, where I just put in more reps. I'm not carrying anything that's not already mine. There's no way that I should break a bone pushing my own body weight. I can get to the point of fatigue and my muscles don't work anymore. That's fine, but that's all on the muscle. That's not on any joint, anything like that. Calisthenics make you stronger than lifting weights. You don't believe me? Look at a 78-year-old calisthenic guy that's been practicing calisthenics his whole life, and a weightlifter. Look at their bodies. Watch one look drawn. the older guy in lifting weights, he start to shrivel up and don't look right. That guy in calisthenics probably got the same body, if not better, and he's functioning. So that's another lie of the world. They're afraid to say which one is best. Calisthenics is way better than lifting weights for life. If you want to show off, then do the weight thing. You understand how that equates to life? You don't really need any juice for calisthenics, any steroids. It's all on you. It's how many reps you got, and that's a mental thing, you know. And then some people put on weighted calisthenics, which still is you going through those exercises. It's like being a fat man doing the squats, carrying more than what your body is supposed to carry, but not on your joints. It's still on the muscles. You understand what I'm saying? Like, it's not isolated. It's compound. So plenty of muscles are growing as you do the exercises. What was that, y'all? I was on something. Abraham. I was reading Abraham. His life was told in the narrative of the book of Genesis. Revolves around themes of posterity and land. Abraham is called by God to leave the house of his father, Terah, and settle in land originally given to Canaan. But they saying leaving his house, they mean the way he was like, Caleb, leave my house. He not leaving my house. He leaving the way we was raised. Origins and calling. Terah, the ninth and descendant from Noah, is the father of Abram. Nahor and Haran is the father of Lot, who is Abraham's nephew. So they is brothers. The entire family lived in Ur. The Chaldees. So the Chaldeans. Ur Kasdim. Commonly translated as Ur, the Chaldeans, the city mentioned in the Bible, the birthplace of the Israelites and Ishmaelites patriarch, Abraham, the birthplace of the Israelites and Ishmaelites patriarch. Does it say Jew? Then don't add it. And make them, this is it. Everybody has the right to make them prove the gap. Prove the gap in Judaism and Christianity, and it was not called Judaism. So we're not going to add or we're not going to subtract. And in these audios that I'm going to play, it's telling you how the Romans did. They took the literature, right? And the Jews did the same thing. The Hasmoneans did the same thing. And it was all political. None of this shit had anything to do with our creator. The people that really kept it at that time would be called Muslims, the Ishmaelites. Chaldees, 1 second, y'all. Let me go back to Abraham up top so you can understand this part. Abraham was called by God to leave the house of his father, Terah, and settle in the land originally given to Canaan. But God now promises to Abraham his progeny. Various candidates are put forward who might inherit the land after Abraham. And while promises are made to Ishmael about founding a great nation, Isaac, Abraham's son by his half-sister Sarah, inherits God's promise. Our God, a pure God. This whole story is flawed. So when y'all see me saying mashallah and salah, like saluting Islam, I don't have a choice. You know, I can't play these games. I'm not playing with the cancer that I had. Y'all play with the shit in y'all lives, and then you show up at a parade and get mowed down with your kids, because that's how it works. That's how God works. His hand, you don't even see his hand. He say he create the light, the darkness, the good, the evil, but you don't read how his hand moves. So I understand. And when I see something like Abraham's son by his half-sister inherits God's promise to Abraham, that's no different than the book of, what is it, Galatians 3 and 16, changing this whole conversation where Abraham's seeds are the ones that get the promise of God. And this seed of Israel, it can't be, y'all. You know, I'm not buying this shit. This is what opens it up to me, the creator, see me standing on his word. Then he give me more word to stand on. And this is absolutely wrong. So even their play on trying to do something with Judaism, period. Judaism is cut the fuck off. It cannot be an incestuous relationship. That did not happen. There's no way. We have a pure God. the same God today, tomorrow, and yesterday. You don't give that up. Once you start playing and trying to explain shit, you're done. It's cut and fucking dry. No brother and sister relationship. It's Leviticus. It wouldn't have been a law for one point. And that's another thing about man. You think you can change God. Y'all constantly trying to change him. Even the people that read the book. You motherfuckers try to explain it out. Well, it was another time. No, you say it was another time. It used to be an iPhone. It's now rotary phones, that shit. Like TVs change, big ass backs, the flat screens. Oh, it was a different time. You arrogant fucks. It ain't no different time for God. Cocksuckers, it's the same. And I stand on it firmly. Israel is not the chosen nation. And y'all can be man fans and want to be theologists. Give a fuck about that. You will never reach me. Never. But I bet I reach you. I bet you can't go to bed once you hear this shit and be like, no, it's got to be another way. And then look for a bunch of liars like yourself to agree on a lie. That's where all your education comes from. That's not what God established. Israel is a fraudulent fucking nation of God. Ishmael had to inherit the promise. He had to. And it's not a child outside of wedlock. Apparently, we didn't see any weddings happening here, did we? People were betrothed and given to people. So where the ring concept come in? More paganism that y'all subscribe to. And then try to act like you want to understand God. You'll never understand him. At the base, y'all operating is wrong. You can't have any dealings with a Israel and it's a fucking incestuous nation. So what it is, I just read it. I guess you can just forget about that because God gave y'all a pass on that shit too. Again, I'm 10 fucking toes down on Islam. It's the original spirituality of Abraham. And while promises are made to Ishmael about founding a great nation, Isaac, Abraham's son by his half-sister Sarah, inherits God's promise to Abraham. Abraham purchases a tomb. He purchases the tomb, Cave of the Patriarchs, to be Sarah's grave, thus establishing his right to the land. So it's about land. In the second generation, his heir, Isaac, is married to a woman from his own kin. From his own kin, thus ruling out Canaanites of any inheritance. So Isaac married a family member. And then they're going to say, well, it was to rule out people. If God gave you something, you don't have to rule a man out of it. We see this in the scripts when Ahaz, the famous Isaiah 7:14, when a promise get made to Ahaz about these two kingdoms that he afraid of, God's like, nah, don't even worry about that shit. You don't have to worry about these sidebar kingdoms because I'm going to take care of them. That was the promise. Look, this young lady is about to give birth to a child, a son. By the time this child is old enough to know right from wrong, those two kingdoms that you're afraid of, they're going to be wiped the fuck out. So he wouldn't be afraid. This is the character God applied to everything. Abraham don't have a pass. You don't have a pass. I don't have a pass. See, God's word is what it is. And if you follow that, you'll be able to see the lies, the inconsistency through this book. Everybody else putting on the show, they need congregational numbers. The reason I don't fuck with Muslims is because they accept Jesus. And the only reason they accepted Jesus politically to get more people to the religion of Muslim instead of practicing Islam. So they allow for a Jesus. No, sir. No, sir. So anybody that's Islamic that's saying that you agree, and it's in 3rd Surah 84, right? Y'all agree with the Jesus? You discredited all of that. I'm standing on it. I don't care what institution you at. Y'all don't want to have this conversation because you can't control me. You know, the word of God freezes. Those buildings, those things, you have your traditions and your rituals, right? God ain't ritual. He's spiritual, motherfuckers. And y'all day is coming. And I guarantee you that pageant that people just got mowed down, that it ain't going to be the last thing to happen over this pagan season. Trust that. Per God, not Noah. Absolutely not Noah, not Evan. Per God, I'm just saying what his word is because I can see it. Much say, y'all don't know how it work. And she right. Terah, the ninth descendant, ninth in descent from Noah, is the father Abram, Nahor, and Haran. Haran is the father Lot, who is Abraham's nephew. The entire family lived in Ur of the Chaldeans. Haran dies in his native city, Ur of the Chaldeans. Abram marries Sarah, who was barren, and the death of Terah, Abraham, Sarah, and Lot depart for Canaan. So he married his fucking sister, but settle in a place named Haran, where Terah dies at the age of 205. God told Abraham to leave his country and kindred and go to a land he would show him and promise him to make him a great nation, bless him. See, this is all literature. The thing is, Abraham gave up being a pagan and start practicing following the one God. You know, he gave up polytheism. They tell him this is literature, but the cut and dry of it is he gave up the way they was worshiping. They want to make this some kind of story. And this is the Jews, the Romans. This is their literature. They changed Hebrew into Judaism. And to tell you that you anti-Semitic, how would you prove that? If they black Jews and you don't like them, wouldn't you be racist? A German Jew, a Polish Jew, a Russian Jew, American Jew, Ethiopian Jews. Those are all different nations. How would I be anti-Semitic? You're not even a fucking people. You know, they call atheists. Wouldn't that cover the shit? Why are you anti-Semitic? Because when you don't believe in Jesus, you're not anti-Semitic. When you don't believe in Christianity, you're not anti-Semitic. But when it comes to Judaism, don't touch it. You're anti-Semite. Same thing with blacks. Any other race here that you are racist about as much as you're trying to offend blacks, you know, put that in place. Two of the biggest tragedies in history happened on which side of, so they say, this African slave trade, Middle Passage, these numbers, and black people, since it support your downtroddenness and you figuring that you get something from America, you enhancing and embellish this shit and go along with it. You can't prove none of that shit. And the same thing with this Holocaust. That's the same bullshit that you see now. The media dredging up these numbers and some sucker asses that's feeling down and out. They go along with it. That shit is not provable. None of it. The Holocaust or this African slave trade. And God's word is something different for both groups. Both of y'all groups should be getting fucked up by God's word. And I can see that the blacks are. You know, I experienced firsthand what goes on with inside of black families, communities. Jews so much, I've never been around y'all, but I know the hand of God is true, and I know y'all not getting away with it. So whatever he can deprive y'all of, he's doing it. And contrary to popular belief, that money, those riches, that ain't the be-all end-all. Y'all trying to harvest child parts now to prolong your life. I know what time it is. Sex trafficking my ass. Y'all taking parts. Y'all trying to get blood. Y'all vampiric. Y'all really believe that shit because these are the fetishes of these other nations. Blood transfusions and shit like that. Y'all thought the blood transfusions is what saved people, right? It's the hand of fucking God to save people. I haven't had chemo. There's been people that had chemo that died. Say I get chemo the same year. Oh, I don't get chemo. The same year somebody gets it. We both live 9 years. Die from cancer. Your doctor, did your doctor prolong his life? Because ain't no doctor prolong mine. I'm a manifest the creator to the point where it's offensive to people. But I don't mind because this world is really fucking offensive trying to tell us what the word of the creator is when it says something completely different. Now, I'm going to drop a couple audio links too, y'all. You know, I need to get to the core Abraham just to get rid of this Jewish shit because that's the biggest, most hurtful lie on the planet, second to niggas being from Africa and trying to weave your way through all this garbage. But we in a prime time right now, you know. I can see it, and I'm going to keep calling this shit out. It ain't about this verse. It ain't about the membership. And they got a lot of niggas enslaved inside of the words itself. Motherfuckers still going out doing the will of Caesar and trying to cover it up. Trying to cover it up in other ways. Fuck your Passover. That ain't of God. That ain't of our creator. We don't have these days to celebrate. I've read the book, and it's an order that we supposed to be in day to day. All y'all men come up with these celebratory days to make yourself look good. The creator said, sit the fuck down. Don't do so much. That was it. Look what y'all did. Y'all got people talking about they can't cook, they can't do this or that. Our God not complicated at all, fuckers.
Important to realize that Josephus wrote in an era...
Hold on, y'all.
Now, these parallels have been seen by...
I'm going into my files. Text, context, subtext, Roman literature, Roman publishing, Roman religion. I got a couple clips I want to let y'all hear, right? And then I'll speak on them after the fact, because I don't really know what they are right now, but let's get it.
Religion was very important in the Roman world. Although they had a secular dimension to their life, religion was all pervasive in the sense that gods and their shrines were everywhere. There was no question in the minds of nearly everybody at that time that there were gods. Gods made their presence felt all the time, whether it be in earthquakes or thunderstorms, in diseases and so on. Gods were ever present. The one thing you had to do with a god was keep them on your side. You made a sacrifice, you hoped that their capricious behavior wouldn't fall badly on you. Religion also was very tolerant in the Roman system. The Romans and all polytheists embraced the idea that that divinity was divided, that there were gods of many different descriptions. When the Romans conquered a province, they didn't try and annihilate their religion. They didn't insist that they adopt Rome's religion. They merely took that religion into their system. They merely assimilated it, allowing that what you call a god by one name, we call by another name. And they had no problem with that. You think of the most impressive temple that stands in Rome, the Pantheon. It was the temple to all the gods. They had no exclusivity about it. You had to keep all the gods, or as many of them as you could, on your side. Now, the only time that Rome seems to have had a problem at the two ends of the empire, with the Druids in Britain and the Jews in Palestine.
They still their people. The Jews... again, it's hard to do business to tear down the Christians without understanding that the Jews hand in. This is all religion, and it's based on politics, how they wanted to serve. The Hasmoneans, the Maccabees, who were noticed or recognized as Jews, wasn't Jews at all. They were Hasmoneans that actually converted to Judaism, which I don't even know where they got that from. There's no religion called Judaism. You know, you had Islam, which was Ishmael. And Ishmael was circumcised and brought up in Abraham's house. So he would have kept the word of his father. And he did. You see Abraham out with this kid. And by the text, it's like Abraham favors this kid. And his half-sister Sarah did not. She favored her child, the incestuous one, and ran off Ishmael and somehow Isaac. This shit, and God is not... Y'all understand how this unfolding? It's like something that you would see today. And that's how people write. And that's not of God, that's of man. This shit is unacceptable. It's not his hand. I don't accept it. I don't accept it at all. So I can't be here with kids and shit and going through this world, looking at what it is, seeing people apply God wrong, and I'll be quiet? Fuck out of here. You gonna be quiet.
When you read our sources really carefully, and you have to do it really, really carefully, because they didn't spell it out for us. It's effectively very well hidden. We have to understand that our literature, a lot of our literature, is essentially propaganda. The Romans are not writing objective history, and all of our literature has been through Roman filters. Perhaps that's the significance of the Dead Sea Scrolls, that this is literature that hasn't been through the...
Important to realize that Josephus wrote in an era when allegory would...
Amen, y'all.
Now, these parallels have been seen by other scholars, but what they failed to notice...
One second, y'all. I'm sorry.
When you read our sources really carefully, and you have to do it really, really carefully, because they didn't spell it out for us. It's effectively very well hidden. We have to understand that our literature, a lot of our literature is essentially propaganda. The Romans are not writing objective history, and all of our literature has been through Roman filters. Perhaps that's the significance of the Dead Sea Scrolls, that this is literature that hasn't been through the Roman filters.
It's important to realize that Josephus wrote in an era when allegory was regarded as a science. Educated readers were expected to be able to see another meaning in religious text.
Another meaning.
Important to realize that Josephus wrote in an era when
When you read...
Now, these parallels have been seen by other scholars, but what they failed to notice is that they occur in the same sequence, and thereby they create a typological pattern.
The Flavian thesis, it's trying to read these texts in context, because in any given text, you've got the text in the first instance, and then you've got the context, the environment in which it happens, and of course, in all of these texts, also, you've got a subtext. So you've got text, context, and subtext, and you have to be able to read all of those things. And unfortunately, many religious people who are coming out of seminaries, who are coming out of religious colleges, they're just not being trained in this sort of level of reading. They're instead being trained to just read on one level, which is a literal level, and I think that that's very unfortunate, and that that really needs to be challenged.
I'll play that again, but that's exactly what I'm talking about. When I take the book of Isaiah, right, it's a text that's being written. The text said, "Behold, a young woman is with child, about to give birth to a son. Let her name him Emmanuel." Now, if I read that, and this is I read the same thing in Isaiah. And even though the Jews wrote, like, came over both books, they had to leave some freedom for themselves over the Romans. So where they changed it at, it couldn't be a crazy change. They didn't believe in Jesus. So they had to leave the book to where Jesus wasn't involved in it. So their text had to be spot on to what they was talking about. You know what I mean? It had to alleviate anything out of it. The Romans always put mystery in it, or the possibility of this. They never wanted you to understand exactly what was going on. So this is Isaiah 7 and 14 in the Torah. And then I'll read the same verse in the King James Version. "Assuredly, my Lord will give you a sign of his own accord. Look, the young woman is with child and about to give birth to a son. Let her name him Emmanuel." That's the text. All right. That's the basic text. Now I'll read the basic text, the same verse in Isaiah from the New Testament, 7 and 14. "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." That don't sound anything like what I just read, but look at it. "The Lord himself will give you a son." Behold, a virgin. He's saying, behold, a virgin. Like, it's one there right then. But that's not what they say. They left some shit out. So now the text, the context, you understand text, context, subtext, subtext, and context. Text is the written word. The context is what's going on. The subtext is why it's going on, right? "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Now, for the Romans, they make it look like, oh, it's down the street somewhere. This is about to happen some years from now. But why is that lady, the why is she's right there at that moment? You know, that's why he's using her. She's right there. "Behold, a virgin shall," you know what I'm saying? "A virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call him Emmanuel." But that's not the end of it. The next verse said, "Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and good, evil and choose the good. For before the child shall know it, refuse the evil and choose the good, the land that Arborus shall be forsaken, and both her kings. So that's the way that the Romans write. All fucked up. Nobody understands what they're talking about. So the Jews had to keep it a little more closer to what the book was saying so they could have their freedom, even though they some fucked people too. So they're talking about two kings. This is a prophecy that Isaiah is giving to Ahaz. The text, the context, and the subtext. The context is this motherfucker is afraid that these two kings gonna fuck him up. You know what I'm saying? The context of why this is even happening. The text is read out for itself. You heard the text, but the context is he's afraid of these two kings. The subtext is that woman there with her baby, her pregnancy, she gonna give birth. And this is the promise that God is with him. That's what Emmanuel. By the time that child is old enough to know right from wrong, blah, 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 those two kingdoms going to be no more. And you just read it. Read it in the context because something is going on in that particular time. The Romans always needed you to see in some other way. That's the Christianity. They actually invented the Christianity. And it's the same kind of situation to where Titus has made himself the Jesus, but the whole thing is to take over these other religious politicians, which are the Jews, because the Hasmoneans, they found the book, you know, or they started practicing what they saw the Judites practicing, some kind of way in travel, maybe trade, and everybody that was around each other. I played the syncretism, you know, with the dominant religion, usually the one to take over. But back in those days, money was everything, and families married into money. The Herods married into Judaism, supposedly the McAfees. They were a rich family, and it was about money. None of these people actually gave a fuck about the word. The Christians and the Jews were spawned off of money. That's it. The Jews hijacked the word of Abraham one way. The Christians hijacked it another way. The Muslims kept it. You know, Islam kept it until they became political, or the money part. And supposedly Muhammad gets the credit for cleaning up the temple, the Kaaba, whatever. Again, a graven image that I can't honor. Muhammad I can't honor as much as I can't honor Jesus. It's pure Islam, mastering yourself off the word the Most High left for Moshe. The rest of these things are religious agreements. I disagree with all of it, because the scripts don't support any of it. You know, like, that's man changing. So let's see. I bet, y'all.
Now, these parallels have been seen by other scholars, but what they failed to notice is that they occur in the same sequence, and thereby they create a typologic pattern.
The Flavian thesis, it's trying to read these texts in context. Because in any given text, you've got the text in the first instance, and then you've got the context, the environment in which it happens, and of course, in all of these texts also, you've got a subtext. So you've got text, context, and subtext, and you have to be able to read all of those things. And unfortunately, many religious people who are coming out of seminaries, who are coming out of religious colleges, they're just not being trained in this sort of level of reading. They're instead being trained to just read on one level, which is a literal level. And I think that that's very unfortunate, and that that really needs to be challenged.
It's an agenda.
By studying the multiple layers in these ancient texts in the original Greek language, Joseph Atwell was able to discover not just a handful, but over 40 typological parallels between the Gospels and the works of Josephus, which show that the ministry of Jesus Christ followed in exact sequence the military campaign of Titus Flavius through parallel names, locations, and concepts.
All right. Still going, y'all.
By studying the multiple layers in these ancient texts in the original Greek language, Joseph Atwell was able to discover not through parallel names, locations, and concepts.
Once I understood the system that the Flavians were using to link Jesus and Titus, I was able to discover dozens of these parallels between Jesus and Titus. And what was amazing is that they occurred in the same sequence. And this simply proves that this was deliberate, that these unusual parallels had been created by the Flavians as a signature. It is their way of telling posterity that they authored the Gospels. These parallels are the Flavian signature of the Gospels.
The Flavians were Caesars as well. Rulers of Rome are called the Caesars. These was the Flavian group. Josephus was a Flavian too. So he was their what they call historian. So of course he's writing with a Roman swing on it or their face on it. You know what I'm saying? So next.
Gospels are not analogous to history. They are analogous to historical fiction. In other words, a drama has been inserted into an historical setting. The emphasis is totally different. It's an unreal drama. If you think about the Gospels, they are almost primarily concerned with the last week of Jesus's life, the Passion. You know, it takes up most of the material. It is simply a drama inserted into a more or less realistic historical background.
Let's keep it moving.
Paint the scene then. Rome is the great and emerging imperial power. It colonized the East as the Eastern Empire of Greece declined. In the areas it took over, it used, in the first phase, client kings. In other words, it found those members of the local aristocracy that would collaborate with Rome. And they would happily do so because Rome preserved their position.
I'm going to stop it right there. For all the black people that think that it's white supremacy, it's not white. That just explained it. These are two different races, different religions. But as long as they can keep their position and their power, they don't give a fuck who rule. And they'll keep you in line just as long as they get theirs. You've seen it with Al Sharpton, any of your black leaders, and it's happening at a lower level now. Money not involved. The payoff is your emotions, because everybody get judged in the court of public opinion, not in law. And as long as they can get you to think one way, they can get you to act that way. So you see it with Trump being a racist, all this shit that didn't pan out. But then when this shit hit the fan, there's no acceptance for the so-called black people from their hand and their own fucking demise, because they went along with somebody that they celebrated, that they idolized. And one of the basic rules for worshiping our creator is no false images, no idols, anything that resemble anything in the sky, anything on the earth, anything under the earth. Basic shit that y'all brush off and think that God ain't gonna charge you for. And then y'all motherfuckers had the nerve to say, why do bad things happen to who?
Let's paint the scene then. Rome is the great and emerging imperial power. It colonized the East as the Eastern Empire of Greece declined. In the areas it took over, it used, in the first phase, client kings. In other words, it found those members of the local aristocracy
sellouts
would collaborate with Rome, and they would happily do so because Rome preserved their position. So the classic example of it is, of course, the Herodian family. Herod was a Roman puppet, but Herod ruled his own provinces in his own way and with a rod of iron.
Herod.
Religion was very important in the Roman world. Although they had a secular dimension to their life, religion was all pervasive in the sense that gods and their shrines were everywhere. There was no question in the minds of nearly everybody at that time that there were gods. Gods made their presence felt all the time, whether it be in earthquakes or thunderstorms, in diseases and so on. Gods were ever present. The one thing you had to do with a god was keep them on your side. You made a sacrifice, you hoped that their capricious behavior wouldn't fall badly on you.
Okay, y'all got one more, then I'm gonna dip one out.
The Jews, of course, didn't have statues. What the Jews had was literature. So what the Romans did, they couldn't take over the statues, they took over the literature. They destroyed the existing literature, they destroyed the Torah scrolls, and they created their own literature.
Torah was actually used to create a parody of Torah, namely the Gospel of Matthew, because it is based on the same five books, Moses, which are the first five books of the Old Testament, and they were used to create Matthew as a sort of parody or fake Torah.
Yeah, folks, we gonna get the Christianity up out of here. That's the only way that people can see straight. And one of the biggest problems that they succeeded in doing was tying Jesus into God. Because when people get rid of Jesus, when people had that stroke of genius and realize that Jesus not real, then they just dump the creator as well. You know, and atheism, whether y'all know it or not, is a religion. It was in direct opposition to Christianity. And it's the same thing. They both religion. Atheism just wasn't with the theology. And theology is not the belief or disbelief in the creator. It's the study of it. So atheism was without theism, without theology. It wasn't without a creator. So all you dumbass people saying you don't believe in God, you are atheist. You're not an atheist because you don't believe in God. You're a goddamn fool that you don't believe in the creator. You know what I'm saying? You don't fuck your sister, you believe in the creator. You don't fuck your mother, you believe in the creator. Not believe, he in you. And you can't go past some of those things. Now, how bad we are, how fucked up we are, some of these inherent things that the creator put in us not to do, we'll never do. Then some of the things we'll run a fucking muck on. We'll be like, clean, eat right, all this. You'd be a fucking murderer. You know, it don't matter. And what we do as humans, we'll give all those other attributes the one up over the sin. The sin wipes out everything. You know it does. That's why bad hits so much more. You do all these good things in your life and one good thing, one bad thing, and then you get titled for the bad thing, right? As you should. Y'all believe in evil. You believe in demonic possession. You believe in people being evil at heart. But ask you about somebody having an angelic possession. Because demons and angels, they people. The light, the darkness, the good, the evil. God called us the creator, my bad. Called us gods. I taken you for divine beings. Like that's us, angels, divine beings. And you only can be divine when you're doing the order of our creator. Otherwise, you're not divine. You're not the light. You're not an angel or the creator. Those are the options. You don't get to set them, though. I don't get to set them either. But I like them. I like them a lot because it freed me up from all this fuck shit that y'all got going on. And I could be offensive, but offensive with doing right. Y'all fucking minds. They should have never let me get my hands on this book. I'm going to torment the fuck out of motherfuckers with the word of God. So if you don't like me, cool. You just identified yourself. Let me shout out the family before I break out. Ralph Nephew, appreciate that dig, that find. And if any of the rest of y'all got anything that y'all think that's pertinent to what we talking about, send it to me, man. Text me 410-504-3121. That's 410-504-3121. When you text your name first. Tell me who you is before you send any message. Text your name because I got a answer machine on my phone that people won't be able to get through until I lock their name in. You know what I'm saying? So text me your name and then I lock your name and then text me what's going on. Now, these are my mechanisms to stay free of the world, controlling my energy. It's not because you're afraid of anybody. Like before, that would be me. I'm going to address all of them. Like you're not. You're getting worn out with dummies and they not the real issue. So I got dummy be gone all over the place. You know what I'm saying? And I'm offensive with certain shit out the gate. So some people know they can't even approach me. Shout out the old bastard King J. I remember you, dog. The creator sent you to put me on the next level to where I say I am a teacher. I do teach. Because we got all these universities and people and motherfuckers out getting run down at Christmas festivals that's pagan. And I know better than that. Goddamn right, I'm a teacher. And shout out to the family that understood that before me. You know, I appreciate y'all. Thank y'all for trusting me with y'all time. I always say it. Nephew Jarrell, I appreciate that this morning. Little brother Brennan, you always here. OGP text me this morning. What's up, OG? Dr. Chu, Dolo, Relly, King, Jay, I appreciate all of y'all in this walk, man. Sister Jessica, Sister Jackie, Sister Miriam, Sister Laverne, Sis Lo, Bree, I appreciate all of y'all, man. So I think I'm going to get another video up for later on today. It's at 10:51, 10 of 11 right now. I think I'm going to chow down, get something on my stomach. Y'all, appreciate y'all coming through. Trust me with your time again. Shalom, Islam, Shalom Aleikum, Alhamdulillah, Mashallah, God bless. Enjoy y'all day, folks.